Let's talk a little bit about our evolutionary heritage and why this presentation is so goes against gut intuitions, goes against much of the advice you might have received, and talk about the cutting edge of the research on the topic of social intelligence and how we behave as human beings. Specifically, I want to talk about the fight or flight response and tribalism. The fight or flight response is our gut reactions, our intuitions. It's one aspect of what we are about, how we feel comfortable. We are evolved to live in the savanna environment. So that's the environment in which we feel comfortable, the savanna environment. That's where our gut feels comfortable. And so we developed strong fight or flight responses, and that was to escape saber-toothed tigers. You might have heard about this as the saber-toothed tiger response or the lizard brain. So we deal with any threat in our environment as though it's a saber-toothed tiger, because that is how our ancestors adapted. We are the descendants of those who treated every threat like it was a saber-toothed tiger. The other ones didn't really survive, the saber-toothed tigers. It was better to jump at shadows. It was better to jump at one shadow than to avoid one saber-toothed tiger, than to get eaten by one saber-toothed tiger. So this natural evolutionary consequence. So that's one dynamic that's going on, still very strongly impacting us. The other one is tribalism. We evolved to live in groups, tribes of people who look just like us, behave just like us, who are our family. And that's the second thing that's going on, that's very powerfully driving all of our responses in the modern day, tribalism. So these are two things that our gut feels comfortable with. These are our gut intuitions, these are our reactions. And this is what we have to fight every day, or what you have to fight every day in your HR activities, what I have to fight every day in my consulting, coaching, and speaking, to help people overcome fight or flight responses and tribalism. This is the underpinning of the very surprising and pleasantly surprising behavior, the resistance to change that we talked about. So this is part of basic human nature. What you're doing heroically is fighting human nature. It's very important for you to realize, I'm going to repeat this again, what you're doing is fighting human nature in your HR activities. It's very unnatural for us to work in large, higher educational institutions. That's not a natural thing for us to do. It's just not natural. And so doing that will really go against this fight or flight response in many cases and tribalism in many cases. And so you have to understand and anticipate when the fight or flight response will arise in your faculty and staff, and when the tribalism will arise in your faculty and staff, and address that. So as I mentioned, it was a good fit for the savannah. It was a bad fit for the modern world. You can see it in real life. You know, here, you had a nice buffet breakfast, right? And in the savannah, it was really important for us to eat as much sugar as possible. Very, very important for us to eat as much sugar as possible. Unfortunately, that doesn't really work very well in the modern environment. Now, I don't know about you. I know I overate some of that French toast. It was delicious. Some of you might have overeaten something else, right? It's very easy to do so. Why is that? Well, because our gut reaction pulls us to eat all the sugar. So that's how we survived. And that's a problem, obviously. So it's a problem for our physical health. It's a problem for healthy organizational culture. And so that's the broader framework that I want you to be thinking about that really goes against much of the advice you might have received, you might hear in the future to go with your gut. So let's talk a little bit about how our mind works, what's going on. We have, so forget about the old ids, subconscious, superconscious, the Freudian stuff. That's been long superseded. There are approximately two, roughly speaking, thinking systems. The autopilot system, which is our gut response, mainly with the fight or flight and the tribalism. It's very subconscious, fast, automatic, habitual. Super quick, it reacts in milliseconds. It's great in many ways. It takes us out of the way of a moving car. You don't want to be thinking for a long time before you do that. That's a good way for us to react. And assesses threats in many cases. It's good for physical threats. It's not good for abstract thinking, for complex thinking, for institutional thinking. For that, there's the intentional system. There's the logical, rational, conscious, slow, effortful system. When you're trying to resist that second piece of chocolate cake or cookie or, you know, toast, French toast, that's what you're using. And you could see the effort, the willpower you're putting in to resist taking that. So that's what you see in real life. And the same effort you're putting in to resist the tribalism, to resist the fight or flight response, and so are all the other staff, and so are the faculty. To behave in a civilized manner in a higher ed institution or other complex modern organization. Now, there are over 100 specific problematic modes of thinking, like the halo and horns effect that we found. They're called cognitive biases. So you might have heard of them. These are dangerous judgment errors, specific types of frequent mistakes we make as human beings just because we're biased, unfortunately, in these ways. And it's nothing to be ashamed about, the tribalism and the halo and horns effect. It's highly problematic when it's brought up as something to be blameworthy or shamed about, because it's a part of a natural human reaction. It really won't help in the long term to use blame or shame to address these problems. When you talk about them as part of what it means to be a human being, and at the same time, to live in a civilization means overcoming these issues. We can still have these feelings. The question is, how do we respond to them?